Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Is the sound okay? Good. So I wanted to start just by, first let me tell you, if I leave something out, you want to ask a question, you can find me on Twitter at the bottom. That's the Twitter address. But I wanted to start today by telling you why I'm here. Why did I get up this morning to do this? It was Vegas, and it wasn't a clear decision. So it has to do with something I want. What I want is to end addiction. And I don't mean end your addiction or that guy's addiction. I mean end addiction the way we ended polio. I want my granddaughter to tell her friend, you know, my grandpa was a doctor and he used to treat this disease called addiction. And it was really horrible. It killed a lot of people. And I want that friend to say, huh, never heard of it. That's what I want. And that's why I'm here. And you're probably thinking, well, he can want it. But, you know, how likely is that to happen? But we don't remember this picture. I was born in the 50s. That's when this picture was taken. There were acres of rooms just like this, filled with people in iron lungs. There were companies that dedicated millions of dollars to building places like this because we were always going to need them, because polio had always been with us, and we were never going to get rid of it. When I grew up, my family wouldn't let me go to a public swimming pool. I could only swim if I went to a friend's house and they had a pool, because, you know, they had closed the public swimming pools. And my mother still didn't trust them, even though we'd been vaccinated with polio. We don't remember this, but polio killed a lot of people. And it was chronic for a lot of people. It destroyed a lot of lives. It was a huge drain on our gross domestic product, just like addiction is today. So how could we do this? Well, we don't have a vaccine for addiction. And if anybody's thinking, but I heard there's a cocaine vaccine or there's a nicotine vaccine. Yeah, you know, they're working on vaccines for specific drugs. But as I think you heard Monday, even if you got rid of a specific drug, you're not doing anything about the disease of addiction, which resides in the brain. And we'll talk about where that is a little bit more today. But we're not going to vaccinate against addiction. We're not going to make addiction go away. So what should our goal be then? Our goal should be more recovering people now and in the future. So that's what we're making. We're making more recovering people now and in the future. And everything we do every day should be focused on making more recovering people now and in the future. And somebody might be thinking, well, isn't that what we're doing? Isn't that already happening? Well, yes. But we haven't fixed it, and it's been 100 years, and you may say, why haven't we fixed addiction? We've been working on it for more than 100 years in this country. Why haven't we got this thing fixed? We're Americans. Americans fix their problems. Right? Why haven't we fixed this one? Well, it says in the big book of AA, our problems, we think, are of our own making. And a little bit of what I want to talk about today is how we might be in our own way. How the words we use, the things we say, the way we think might be what's stopping us from ending addiction. Because words are important. And I'd like you to imagine that you just got elected to Congress. Without a debate. So people like you, you didn't get in the way of traffic. You're a really popular congressperson. And an aide walks in and they say, Congressman, we got this real problem back in the district. I mean, we've got rampant substance abuse. These people are using this substance, man, and it's just all over the place. And this substance is in schools, and it's in the jails, and people are buying it and selling it, and it's just terrible. We have a terrible problem with substance abuse. Congressman says, well, that's easy. I'm going to go down the hall to some colleagues. We're going to get together. We're going to make some laws. We're going to outlaw this substance. Problem solved. Now, it's been another year. And one other aide comes in and says, Congressman, we've got this real problem back in the district. There are a lot of people addicted to this substance. And I know you passed laws last year outlawing the substance, and they honestly want to stop. But they're addicted to it. They're attached to it. They can't let it go. And they're trying. But, you know, we need to do more to help them let go of this substance. This substance is bad. You say, well, we made those laws, but, you know, I understand they want to stop, but maybe if we made it a little bit more expensive, maybe if we made it a little bit harder to find, a little bit harder to get, a little bit more dangerous to use, maybe they'd be able to make the jump and stop. So he goes back down the hall to his colleagues, and they make another law, increasing the penalties and, you know, outlawing the substance even more. But another year goes by, and you actually get reelected. Surprise. And another aide walks in and says, Congressman, we have this terrible problem back in the district. Did you know that 10 to 20% of our citizens have a brain illness called addiction? It's primary. It's chronic. It's not caused by those substances we were worried about. It's already there in the brain. It's largely genetic. And we've been seeing effects in substances, but we see effects in other things too. And this disease is costing us huge, huge problems. And we don't have a lot of good, easy-to-get treatment for it. And people don't even know sometimes treatment's available. Well, you as a congressman now are having a completely different response to your aide, aren't you? You're not thinking about running down and making a quick law to outlaw something. You realize you have a real problem on your hands. Now, let's imagine you work for an insurance company. I know, that'll probably be a stretch for a lot of you. And you work for an insurance company, and you're at a meeting, and someone comes in with the same thing and says, you know, we're losing millions on substance abuse. And you think, okay, well, substance abuse, you know, that's a choice. That's a decision. I learned in insurance school on the first day that the only thing you can't insure is human choice. So, you know, we really don't want to be dealing with this. Let's just not treat it. Let's just not pay for it. Well, the government makes us pay for it. Okay, well, look, can someone figure out some ways we don't pay for it? Because we just need to stop the bleeding. And a few months later, you go to another meeting, and they say, you know, our insureds are addicted to these substances, and we need we're sending them to treatment. We're paying millions for treatment. And they're going to treatment, and they come out, and they just use another substance. Or they go back to the old substance. And we're spending millions, but we don't feel like we're getting anything. And you say, okay, well, look, it doesn't sound like anybody really knows what to do about this problem, and we're just losing lots of money, and could someone just kind of put some brakes on this so that we don't have to be losing millions of dollars? A few months later, you go to another meeting, and somebody says, did you know that we're losing millions of dollars in emergency room visits, in hospital days, in operations, in chronic illness, and that 70% of the money we spend is actually only on 20% of the people? And it turns out those 20% of the people have a primary chronic brain illness we didn't even know they had. That's not why they're going in the hospital. They're going in the hospital for infections and operations and things like that, but it all starts with this brain illness, and we weren't even looking at it. Well, now you as an insurance person, you're having a completely different way of thinking about this. Now I'd like you to imagine you're a patient. And you call up a place, and you say, I need help. And they say, oh, well, we help substance abusers like you. We can help you stop abusing that substance. Because when people are abusing that substance, that's really bad for them. And it has a lot of bad consequences. So you come to our treatment place, and we'll treat your substance abuse, and you won't be a substance abuser anymore. And, you know, he's a good shopper, so he's calling around to a lot of other places. So he calls another place, and they say, oh, you're addicted to that substance. Well, we help people who are addicted to that substance. Come on and come to our treatment program, and And we'll teach you how to not be addicted to that substance. It'll all work out. And you'll feel a lot better when you're not using that substance anymore. And he thinks, I've never felt better before when I wasn't using this substance. What's this magic going to happen now? And so you call a third place. And they say, oh, yeah. Sounds like you have addiction. We treat that. And we understand that the drugs that you're talking about, the things that got you in trouble, really aren't the disease. We understand those weren't the problem. We understand those were your solution. And that the problem was how you felt all your life, probably. And we can help with that. And our goal isn't to take the thing away from you and make you feel miserable and wait till you feel better. Our goal is to treat you for the underlying illness so that your brain doesn't need the drug or want the drug anymore. We don't want to have a fight and a war in your brain. And so, as I was talking, you might have been thinking which one of those treatment places you wanted to go. Because our words matter. They tell people what our reality is. Here's another set of words we use, besides substance abuse, which is one of my favorites. Here's another one. It's all simple. It's a letter. It goes at the end of the word addiction. How many addictions are there? Well, DSM says there are 11. 10 substance use disorders and gambling. That's really a kind of a neat little thing. It's all in a nice package. You can get an addiction, go to treatment, get over that addiction, go out, get another addiction, come back, go to treatment, get over that addiction. In fact, you could get a little book and collect all 11, get a stamp each time. Addiction, too, is a real problem because it focuses on the substance, not on the disease. It doesn't focus us to put a solution to the problem, it focuses us on a consequence. Avoiding a consequence. Who does that sound like? People who don't want to solve the problem at a deep level but just want to avoid the consequences. We see those people a lot. And in a way, that's us. Because we're focusing on the drug, which is a consequence, and not on the brain illness. Now, we all live in DSM world, right? The DSM paradigm that we operate under right now was first written down in 1981. The American Psychiatric Association published DSM-3 in 1981, and that's still the model. I know we changed the criteria in 3R and in 4 and in 4TR, and now we're on 5, and it looks like a lot of work's been done, but the underlying paradigm isn't different. It goes like this. You're pretty normal. You start using a drug. You get hooked on that drug, and then you start using that drug in strange and weird ways, which we don't like. And now you meet behavioral criteria around that drug, and you have a disease, an illness, a diagnosis. The first study in the literature on addiction as a brain disease wasn't until 1988. And since then, we've had the Human Genome Project, the decade of the brain. We've learned so much about this disease. And the paradigm that was written down in 1981 hasn't changed. It's pre-scientific. It has been informed by none of the scientific findings on the disease of addiction. ASAM's definition, which you heard about Monday, was written in 2011 and did take advantage of all those scientific findings. And I know you saw this before on Monday. I just want to drive home one point. That in this definition, the three sentences are completely backwards from DSM. In this definition, it says, first, you have the illness. Second, the illness causes symptoms. And third, the symptoms is what drives you. Symptoms are what drive you to seek reward and relief. And remember, in DSM, it was the drug came first, the drug caused some symptoms, and now you have a disease. It's completely backwards. So we need a new system if we're going to end addiction in this country. We need a new system that actually takes care of the problem as it exists in nature and not the one we made up in 1981. Not the one we want to treat, but the one that we're actually faced with. And this system's going to have to answer some questions. Questions like, if addiction is a disease, where's the broken bone? Where's the physical site? The definition of a disease is the absence or a function or malfunction of a part of the body. Well, where's the part of the body? Where's the broken bone? I'm going to show you the broken bone in just a bit. If addiction's not limited to drugs, how are we going to stay sober? And what does sober mean? We'll talk about that. And if addiction's chronic, when does treatment end? That's a new question for us. And we'll talk about that. And also, if addiction's progressive, what hope do we have? If addiction gets worse as we age, whether we're using or not, and I'll show you in a bit that that's actually the case, aren't we all doomed and do we have no hope? And no, I'm going to show you the hope too. But I want to start with this graph because this is the graph that I'm assaulted with most times when I talk to doctors. Because you know, a lot of doctors, specifically my colleagues in epidemiology, don't think addiction is a disease. And this is the graph they prove it to me with. They'll say, Howard, you're wrong, because if you were right, prohibition wouldn't have worked. And I sort of thought, prohibition worked? And they show me this graph. And they say, yes, absolutely, prohibition worked. Look, this is a graph of how much alcohol we drank, every man, woman, child, and infant in this country from 1900 to 2005. This one is, the government's kept track of that. And the missing data is just the prohibition years. But look at those years before prohibition and after. We, the year after prohibition, only drank half as much as a country in, per capita as we did before prohibition. And the epidemiologists look at that and they say, see, prohibition worked. We drank less. And I look at that and I think, well, data's data. They weren't lying back then. Nobody in 1924 knew that I was going to give this talk today. They didn't fudge this. It's nobody's fault. It's real data. And I can't argue with it, but I also know the disease. And I know that people don't just stop using what they get and then feel bad. So I thought, well, what else does the government keep track of back then? What else did the government keep track of back then that we could look at? Did someone have an idea? Cigarettes. The government's also measured how many cigarettes you've smoked, every man, woman, child, and infant in this country, since 1900. To 2005. That's the latest data I have. And when you want to see if two things interact in science, you multiply them. That way, if one goes up and the other one goes down, you'll know it. If they both go up, they both go up. They both go down, they both go down. So you make a product of the two things. And that's what I did. And I called it the nicotine alcohol dopamine load, and you'll see why in a little bit, why we call it dopamine load, because you're getting dopamine from both the nicotine and the alcohol. And that's really what we're looking for in addiction, and I'll show you why in a bit. So if you look at that over time, we entered addiction, we entered the prohibition smoking and drinking a certain amount, and we ended prohibition smoking and drinking that same amount. We just drank less and smoked more. Now, there's another thing to notice on this graph. Look at the red lines. Ooh, sorry. The red line before prohibition is going up at a moderate pace. And after prohibition, look at how that the slope gets much bigger. Now, there are two possible reasons for that. One is that there's very good literature that abstinence actually increases craving. So when you spend 9 years not letting anyone drink, and then you say, okay, now you can drink, there's an explosion. But that explosion just didn't pass and go. It kept going. And the other possibility is These were stressful times. This was the Great Depression. This was entering World War II. Look at that bump above the trend line there, and that peak, that's 1945. The war ends, and our smoking and drinking comes back down to trend line. Stress plays an important role in how much dopamine we're looking for from outside, and I'm going to show you exactly why that is in just a bit. Let's take another look at this same graph. This is a longer view of this graph. This is the dopamine load from nicotine and alcohol over time. And Gary just looked at me. So let me say that these graphs, everybody's taking pictures, the graphs are in my book, and Gary's got the book at the bookstore in the place. Did I do good? Okay. All right. And I told him that was going to be hard for me to do, but I did it. Okay. So look at, this goes up until about the 70s, right? It plateaus, and then we start smoking and drinking less as a country in 1980. Now, I got to admit, I don't remember the 80s very well. I was in medical school. I was in the Navy. I was in my internship residency. I was either reading a book or at sea, literally. So I don't know what you guys were doing in the 80s. But did the 80s get so good that no one needed to smoke and drink anymore? It wasn't that bad. You know, it wasn't where I was, but you know, maybe. But I thought, okay, that couldn't really be it. It didn't get like so much less stressful for us. And our lives today aren't less stressful than they were then. What else could it be that the government keeps track of, remember? Because got to measure it. I heard somebody say crack, and yeah, that could be it. But you know, the government didn't measure crack, just like it didn't measure alcohol during Prohibition, because there wasn't any, right? So they don't measure crack today, because there isn't any. So, what else did they measure?
Disco?
Disco, yeah. They could measure disco balls. No, they measured your calorie intake. And we don't have data going back to 1900 on calorie intake because, you know, back to the Great Depression, people couldn't afford food. And then in the war years, we rationed food. And rationing completely wasn't even over until after Korea, and we got out of Korea in 1952. So it wasn't really until the late 50s that we've got good calorie data on every man, woman, child, and infant in this country. And notice, though, that we're pretty steady with our calorie intake until almost exactly the same time when we start smoking and drinking less, we start eating more. Everybody likes to blame McDonald's for the obesity epidemic. I wonder if smoking cessation gave McDonald's a business plan. After I did that, I found out that actually it's not just calories, but there's a specific thing we have in our diet today that we didn't have in the 50s. Here's that same nicotine alcohol graph that you were looking at. And we're going to play the game of whack-a-mole, which we've been playing in this country for over 100 years. You know that game at the arcade. The mole comes up. You hit him with the hammer. While you're doing that, another mole's popping up, and you got to hit him with the hammer. And you're back and forth whacking the moles. And whoever wins that game, you can't win whack-a-mole. It's like thermonuclear war. That is a substance that didn't exist before 1966. And when it was invented in 1966, it slowly started getting exported from where it was invented in Japan and sent over here. And we started making it over here. And for the first few years, it didn't really catch on. And then people who made food started seeing how cheap and easy it was. And it started entering our food supply in the early 70s. And it really took off. That is high fructose corn syrup. And the correlation between the rise of high fructose corn syrup from 1980 to 2000 and the fall of the nicotine alcohol curve is over 90% for the years 1980 to 2000. In 2000, we figured out that high fructose corn syrup wasn't good for us, that it was creating an epidemic of type 2 diabetes. Do you notice about the word epidemic? Nobody ever talks about an epidemic of the brain disease of addiction. We talk about the epidemic of the consequences. We have the epidemics, we have the epidemic lung cancer deaths that came from the smoking years. And then we have the epidemic liver failure deaths that came from the alcohol years. And now we have the epidemic of opioid overdose deaths, which is coming from the opioid years. And this is the third time we've had an epidemic of opioid overdose deaths in this country. And we keep playing whack-a-mole, focusing on the consequences instead of focusing on the cause. But notice, in 2000, we started focusing on this consequence of high fructose corn syrup. And the epidemiologist told us, you know, we told you not to smoke and drink. You did a good job with that. Now we want to tell you don't use so much high fructose corn syrup. Evidently, we're doing a good job of that, too. It's going down. Here's the same graph, but I drew it at a different scale so that this next one will fit. That was going up at a moderate pace until high fructose corn syrup leveled off, and now it's exploded. Anybody want to know, take a guess at what that is? Opioid prescriptions in America. Would it surprise you to know that opioids go to the mu opioid receptor and make a release of dopamine? No, not surprising. We call it the mu opioid receptor. Would it surprise you to know that sugar and high fructose corn syrup goes to the mu opioid receptor and causes a release of dopamine? That's interesting. Would it surprise you to know that alcohol acts at the mu opioid receptor to cause a release of dopamine? Wow. It's a coincidence, isn't it? Would it surprise you to know that nicotine acts as the nicotine receptor, which sits right next to the opioid receptor, and causes a release of dopamine? We keep playing whack-a-mole with all these different things. And when you look at them closely, they're all the same. Here's another view from the National Institutes of Drug Abuse. I've got to say it because they haven't changed the name yet. You cannot compare the pictures across. You can only compare the pictures vertically, because these are four different studies across, done in four different standards. So you can't compare left to right. Just compare up and down. And this is four different studies comparing people with addiction involving a particular, this is overeating, cocaine, alcohol, smoking, and people who don't have addiction involving that behavior or substance. The red is the dopamine receptors. So the more red you have, the more dopamine receptors you have. And what you're seeing here is in every case, whether you're looking at addiction involving drugs or addiction involving overeating and the consequences thereof, you're seeing lower dopamine receptors in the case of addiction. Now, let's shift gears and go back to the future. Specifically, 1939, it was a terrific year. Gone with the Wind, The Wizard of Oz, and the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. Dr. Silkworth had an opinion, and it was put on page one of the first edition. It's now in the Roman numerals, so a lot of people don't read it, but I still think it's the best neurobiological description of this disease ever put in literature. He didn't know why people have addiction, but he was a very astute observer, and he could tell us what he saw. And what he saw were two things. The first thing he said was, there's an allergy of the body. These people aren't normal. They don't have a normal response. And by the way, that's all he meant by allergy. He didn't mean immunologic problem. He didn't mean hay fever. Allergy in the 30s just meant abnormal reaction. And the normal reaction to a few drinks is to feel a little tired and want to go home and sleep. But his patients didn't have a normal reaction. They wanted to go dancing. So it's an abnormal reaction. That's all he meant by allergy. And they not only wanted to go dancing, but they needed some more to drink. And that phenomenon of craving, he said, as it says in this quote, only happens with the disease of addiction. Never happens without. But he also said, but this isn't really a problem. Because if you're allergic to strawberries, you just don't eat strawberries and you don't have a problem. The problem here is they're allergic to alcohol and they can't not drink the alcohol because of something else which he called the mental obsession, which he said stemmed from a common base state shared by all the patients, that they were restless, irritable, and discontented until they could get the ease and comfort from taking a few drinks again. That this was the real problem, this restlessness, irritability, and discomfort. This was the problem because this is what drove people to take the first drink, and then when the first drink got in there, the allergy took over, the compulsion to drink more, and then there would be this endless period of drinking until finally something exhausted. Here's where the allergy lives. There's a group of cells called the ventral tegmental area. They're in the middle of your brain. Those little red parts I showed you, it's right around there. The ventral tegmental area makes and sends dopamine to another group of cells called the nucleus accumbens. Now, the nucleus accumbens, when it sees dopamine, it does a number of things. One, if it's seeing enough dopamine, it sends another signal up to the cortex of the brain saying, everything's cool. You've got enough. Don't worry. And you feel contented. And you're not worried. And if I say, can I have some potato chips? You say, why, sure, I have plenty. And if you don't have enough dopamine, I say, do you mind if I get on your elevator? And you say, get the hell away from me. Because I don't have enough of anything, and all of you want the last little bit that I don't have enough of, and I'm getting pretty irritated about it. And I'm always looking for more dopamine because I don't have enough, so I'm kind of restlessly looking around for dopamine. And then when I find some, it never lasts, so I just stay out of contentment. Restless, irritable, and discontented. But the nucleus accumbens does another thing. When it sees a spike of dopamine, it sends a thank you note back to the ventral tegmental area saying, that was lovely, send more quick. And that signal is the brain's opiate, endorphin. And so let's say you take something that, you know, boosts dopamine. The dopamine hits the nucleus accumbens sends endorphin, the ventral tegmental area sees the endorphin, sends more dopamine, dopamine hits, send more endorphin, more dopamine, endorphin, 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 and it just keeps going until all the dopamine that was lined up in little bubbles, ready to go, is gone. It's exhausted. There is no more dopamine to release, and it starts to fall. It's a high and a crash. And the crash leads dopamine lower. And what do we say about dopamine? Low, more restless, irritable, discontent, more craving, more I need a drink, or I need a whatever. This happens very fast, depending on the drug. How long the dopamine stays up may vary from drug to drug, but the key is that it's the crash that causes the craving, it's the high that causes the crash, and it's the low tone that starts with that gets you the high. Because when people don't have enough dopamine, they have a very high spike from sources of dopamine. And as we raise their dopamine tone, their spike generally comes down. And I'll show you this in a little bit more in detail. So one more thing to this little tiny model, and I know, by the way, that this is a simple model. If any of you are neurobiologists from NIDA, you're probably saying, look at all the inner neurons he's left out. Oh my God, he's left out 6 neurotransmitters and a lot of detail. This is completely bad. This is wrong. He's left out way too much detail. But remember the goal? The goal was not to win the Nobel Prize in neurobiology. The goal was more recovering people now and in the future. So what we need is a working and workable model you can use in your clinic, in your facility, to create more recovering people now and in the future. And it's got to be a simple model. This model only has three moving parts. I've showed you two. Here's the third. There's an input from the amygdala with the chemical neurotransmitter glutamate. Now, the amygdala is where you store your emotional memories. It doesn't remember who did what to who when. It remembers how you felt about who did what to who when. And it remembers what you saw or how you felt when you saw it. And so if you always lit your crack pipe with a red Bic lighter back in the 80s, and you see a red Bic lighter, the amygdala sends a hit of glutamate down to the ventral tegmental area, and you get a squirt of dopamine. You know that term, euphoric recall? That's that. But it isn't euphoric recall. It's euphoria. You're actually getting a hit of dopamine. You're actually getting a high. And what does the high cause? A crash. So you get a real crash. And with the crash comes craving. See the red Bic lighter? Need to go buy some crack. It's all right there in the midbrain. So I mentioned dopamine tone, but I need to tell you a little bit more about it. There are three parts to dopamine tone, only three parts to dopamine tone. You have the amount of dopamine released, you have the number and function of dopamine receptors, and you have the amount of time the dopamine can be on the dopamine receptors. That's it. You increase one of these, you've increased dopamine tone. You decrease one of these, you decrease dopamine tone. You decrease one of these and you increase another one, and maybe you can balance out. And that is where a lot of the hope is going to lie, because with medications, we can increase the release of dopamine. Not in a way that high and exhausting, but in a tonic way. Stable, just to raise dopamine tone, not to make spikes and crashes. And we can also increase the amount of time that the dopamine that is released, stays at the receptor. But here is the key of why medicine will never just be enough. There's no medicine that can increase dopamine receptors. But there's good news here. Because dopamine receptors can be increased, but we have to understand what decreases them in the first place. Yes, there can be genetic decreases of dopamine receptor number, or you could have a dopamine receptor misfunction genetically. But most people who have low dopamine receptor density have it because of a couple of things I'm going to show you. I need to buy some aftershave. Was that cue-induced craving? So this is one of my favorite studies in the scientific literature. If you're animal lovers, you're going to hate it. But I am an animal lover, but it's just so good, and it tells us so much about how to fix this problem. It's so important to know this study. It starts with four infant male monkeys that were normal. Four normal infant male monkeys. And they knew these male monkeys were normal for two reasons. One, they gave them cocaine and they didn't like it. Normal mammals don't like drugs. Holy moly, did you know that? Because if you're normal in dopamine and someone gives you something that gives you more dopamine, now you have too much dopamine. And you know what that feels like? What that we call that? That's OCD. Who signs up for OCD? It's very dysphoric. Nobody likes it. We don't like too much dopamine. We like being in the zone. So if you've got normal dopamine tone, which most mammals do, and somebody gives you something that raises dopamine, you don't like it and you don't want any more of it. Thank you very much. They also knew these little infant monkeys were normal because they put them in PET scans and their dopamine receptors lit up real bright and yellow and shiny. And there are a lot of them. They said, these monkeys have normal levels of dopamine receptors and they don't like cocaine. These are the right normal male infant monkeys we need to for this study. Then they did the experiment. They took the monkeys away from their mothers. Not only away from their mothers, but away from all the other monkeys. Then they were basically in monkey solitary confinement. Couldn't even see each other. Immediately, look at what happened to dopamine receptor density. Falls very low. They went then and offered these monkeys cocaine, and they loved it. Because they had been normal, and cocaine went here, and it didn't feel good. But now they were here, and cocaine went back to normal. and they could feel normal again. And so they loved the cocaine now. And they grew these monkeys up in solitary confinement, avidly using cocaine every day, until they were nice and adolescent, addicted male monkeys, which only takes a few months in monkeys to be adolescent. So then they put these adolescent monkeys in a cage together, all four, in a troop-sized cage. And of course, being four male monkeys, they had to figure out who the alpha was. So these four monkeys start throwing things and biting and hitting, and one of them's the alpha. And he gets his dopamine receptor density back and stops using cocaine. The other three, the subservient ones, the ones who are less than, they don't get a boost in their dopamine receptor just because they're living in a social surroundings anymore. And they continue to use cocaine. So this tells me there are two things that can lower dopamine receptor density, two social stresses. One is being alone, and the other is feeling less than. If you're alone or less than, you're going to have lower dopamine receptor density than is your genetic maximum, and you're going to have more craving and more using. Coincidentally, what do you get from an AA meeting? I'm not alone ever again, and I'm not less than anyone. So we can see how psychosocial aspects of recovery in the 12 steps can actually change the brain. Well, then we got the thing solved, right? Because that's all we need. We'll just give everybody more dopamine receptors and go to meetings all the time and work the steps all the time and everything be fine. Except there must be another problem, because last time I read the stats that came out of AA, and they've stopped producing these stats, but they used to do it on an every 7-year basis, the chance of someone who walks into an AA meeting still going to an AA meeting in a year is only 5%. So for 5% of people who can walk in, sit down, get a sponsor, get sober, and all they need is more dopamine receptors, works great. But what about the guy who has another reason for low dopamine tone? He can't even hear the message to get the more increased receptors. And it isn't only alcohol, and it isn't only drugs. The attachment, by the way, that's what the word addiction means. Addiction was first used in the English language by William Shakespeare, and he got it from a Latin word, addictere, which was a Roman legal sentence passed down when you owed someone money, you became addictere, attached to the guy you owed money to. It was essentially debt slavery. You were attached against your will. Can you think of a better definition of addiction than attached against your will? It's exactly what it feels like. And that attachment is not cortical. It's not, you know, that was a really good feeling. I think I would like to have that feeling all the time. In fact, let me make some moral judgments about that feeling and the other things in my life I'm going to be willing to give up to get that feeling. That thought process doesn't happen. We don't think about this. We don't decide it's a really good idea to get attached to cocaine or alcohol or overeating or gambling. It just seems to be something that happens. And it happens that way to us because it's not a cortical process. It's a biological process of the midbrain. And we don't have any control over it. And it's not just drugs or alcohol. Here's a few other things that you can attach to because you get a spike of dopamine from them. Dangerous or risky behavior. Staying up late, sleeping in, being the center of attention, being liked, making someone smile, or any other way of having power over others, completing a hard task, sexual climax, taking in food. They're the references. Sorry. I know you can't read them. Now, here's a funny thing that's going to happen, because you're going to be politely listening today, and then at 10 o'clock we're all going to leave this room, and you're going to go hear something else, and then you're going to have a break, you're going to hear something else, and you're going to go to lunch, and sometime after lunch, this slide's going to hit you. And you're going to say, huh, I wonder what it would be like if somebody was born with not enough dopamine, and then they started getting attached to making people smile and being the center of attention. And then that was like a drug for them, and that the rest of the world got smaller because nothing else was giving them reward, only that. Huh, I wonder what that person would be like. And then you're going to start thinking of the other things on this list, and you're going to wonder, oh my God, how many different diagnoses really are addiction and we don't realize it? So if it's really not about a drug that we can stay away from, how are we going to stay sober? Well, with the brain definition, we're going to have to stop looking outside at a bottle or a pill or whatever and start looking inside. We're going to have to stop looking at we have to stop looking at our cortex for a solution and understand that the midbrain is what's having the problem. You've heard of this, we have to make the cortex stronger argument, make the midbrain weaker. But remember, the midbrain feeds the cortex. It sends, this nucleus comes and sends a signal to the cortex saying, everything's okay, you got enough, act like a human. And if there isn't enough, it says, you're going to die. You're in survival mode. Don't act nice. Don't be generous. Don't pay attention to others. Focus on yourself, only yourself. You're the only one you can count on. And it's supposed to do that. That's what keeps us alive. The good news is that a lot of this is already part of the 12-step system. 12-step culture and other recovery cultures. So for the inside and outside, now we have a brain thing. We have to not worry about the alcohol, the opiates that the person's taking, but it's more about what I'm feeling and what I'm trying to make better. And we have to focus less on what I'm doing and more on why I'm doing it. It's not the behavior that's important. It's the what I'm seeking when I'm doing the behavior that tells you whether this is part of addiction or not. And we're going to have less focus on the absolute and more focus on the progress. It's easy when it's all about alcohol. You just don't take another drink and you start getting chips and it's days and years and you're proud and it's wonderful. It's a lot more complicated when you have to think about the brain and you have to say, but am I overeating? Am I only sober because I'm overeating and smoking? And I'm only not drinking because of that. And if that's true, what am I really doing to my health? And is there a better way? It's a lot more complicated. And it can be very much less comfortable for us. But you remember the cortex versus the midbrain. Historically, we've been hearing that we have to strengthen the cortex and lower the midbrain. But remember I showed you that the midbrain feeds the cortex. And so we have to refocus that now. This is less about conscious thought and more about behaviors that keep dopamine tone normal. But we already knew that, and this is already there. You can't think your way into new behaviors, but you can behave your way into new thinking. Meeting makers make it. And there's no hierarchy in people feeling less than in 12-step culture, right? Because we all have just 24 hours. You have 27 years? Congratulations. You have 27 years times 24 hours, but you still have 24 hours today. And that makes everybody even, and nobody's the alpha, and nobody's lower, because everybody's horizontal. And you don't have to be the alpha to have more dopamine receptors, because you just have to be everybody equal. You just have to not be less than. And you have enough dopamine receptors. So what is it that actually never ends? It can't be treatment that never ends. Because we're never going to be able to keep people in treatment forever, right? But what is the goal of inpatient treatment? We think of it in our field traditionally as a complete treatment. We want to keep this guy a certain length of time until he's really got it. And we can let him go. And he's on his own and he'll be fine because he's got it. Well, that's just not the way medicine works. That's not the way any part of healthcare works. And while we were over here, away from healthcare, not getting paid for what we were doing, except someone's grandma would send us a check to treat little Billy, okay, we could get away with that. But if we're now part of healthcare, and we have Parity Act, and we have CARA, and we're insurance companies are actually paying us, they're going to expect us to actually act like healthcare. And the goal of inpatient treatment is to create an outpatient. That's it. Period. Why are we all hearing from insurance companies about lower lengths of stay? because they're not interested in Billy getting it. They're interested in when can Billy go to outpatient status and get some more of it. That's it. So what's the goal of outpatient treatment? Well, the goal of outpatient treatment is to create a non-patient, a person who's in recovery, who can self-manage a chronic disease with the help of a recovery culture. Maybe he needs some professional monitoring, and we'll talk about that in a bit, but he doesn't need intensive treatment. And what's the goal of recovery then? To live long enough to die of something else. To die with addiction, not of addiction. And you know what? This is what it is for diabetes. The goal of diabetes treatment is to die with diabetes, not of diabetes. The goal of asthma treatment is to die with asthma, not of asthma. That's how it is with chronic diseases. If this is really a chronic disease, if we want to be treated like people who treat a chronic disease, this is how people are going to treat us. This may not be how we talk to the rest of the world, though. And we have to understand this is what they're listening for, though. So what is the role of the professional in this? Well, of course, we work in the intensive treatment phase. That's probably what most people in this room are doing and what most people in this room are interested in. We're focused on the intense treatment phase. But if it's a chronic illness, we have to monitor recovery. And by monitoring recovery, I don't mean just monitoring drugs. Urine drug testing ongoing is not enough. Because this isn't a disease that starts with drugs. The drugs are the consequences. So how much earlier could we actually catch a decompensation of a recovering person if we were talking about low dopamine symptoms and asking him about his low dopamine symptoms? Because we would catch that low dopamine tone before he got so bad that he had to pick up the first drink or the first whatever. And we could catch this much earlier, and then we could dive in quickly to help. And not with another 8 weeks of treatment, but we just look at what the thing was wrong and fix that one thing. Because remember, what was our goal? My goal, anyway, is to end this thing. And we're not going to end this thing with all of us unless we work more efficiently and can get people back into recovery quicker. Now, I said I'd show you why the disease progresses, and it's a little bit scary, and I have to tell you about it because otherwise you're not going to realize we have to deal with it. We lose ventral tegmental area cells, and we lose dopamine receptors as we age. It just happens. We lose them faster when we're using, but even if we're not using, they're going down every year. That means our dopamine tone is going down every year. That means we're all going to get addiction if we live long enough. That means addiction gets worse as we age. But there's good news, too, because while addiction progresses, so does recovery. And we're peeling the onion. And we're... I got ahead of myself. And we're growing in spirit, which really just means that the world is getting bigger for us. One day, the world used to be me in the bottle. And now the world's got so much more in it. And each little thing we get into our world is one more thing that makes us not alone and gives us that dopamine tone to not feel restless, irritable, and discontent, to not get self-centered. We like to think of, well, self-centered people get addiction, but actually it's the disease of addiction that's self-centering. If I took 100% of humans and created low midbrain dopamine tone in them, they would all be self-centered. It is a consequence of low dopamine tone, not the cause of it. And we grow, we grow in this spirit, but we also have to be cognizant of this is a biological brain disease. Ask yourself, do we give our recovering old timers permission to go see someone like me, to go see an addiction doctor for treatment of symptoms for the biological disease of addiction? No, we don't. You've been sober for 25 years. Just work your program more. It's always worked, and that'll be fine. If we don't realize that we're biologically losing dopamine tone, we're not going to realize that this guy might need some medical help. Yes, even 25, 35 years after getting sober. There's a lot we can offer people in good recovery who have older brains. I'll show you some of that in a bit, but there's a lot. And remember, if we want to get more recovering people now and in the future, that means we need to get our old-timers to live longer, because each one of them creates more recovering people, right? And if he's going to die 10 years early because of low dopamine tone, who isn't going to get in recovery because of that? And if I can keep him in recovery another 10 years before he dies, how many other people have a chance at recovery? Let me talk a little bit about the future, because it's probably going to blow your mind. First of all, there's the genetics. We're using genetics today to sequence treatment for this brain illness. And I'm going to show you that on a single slide. We're just going to run through it. It's not going to be everything, but just the quick and dirty. And if you think that's really cool, and it is cool, wait till you meet the microbiome. There are more bacterial cells living in your colon than there are human cells in your body, and they're very active. They're making neurotransmitters. They're making hormones. They're digesting your food and producing things with it that are changing your brain, and you don't even know what's going on. As scary as it might be when you heard me say it's the midbrain running the show, not your cortex, how scary do you think it's going to be when you realize it's not even your midbrain, it's your gut bacteria running the show? There are studies showing that you can take leanness and transplant it with the microbiome. Give an overweight mouse bacteria from a fecal transplant from a lean mouse, and the fat mouse loses weight. You can do the opposite. And the opposite's been done in humans, where people needed a fecal transplant because they had a terrible gut infection. They had to have their gut sterilized, and they need to have their gut repopulated. And you want someone you trust. So in these cases, they'd get a relative. And sometimes they picked a relative with a weight problem, and then that person who never had a weight problem all of a sudden gets obese. And they're now looking at drug-using mice and using fecal transplant to get drug-using mice to stop using drugs. This is going to give a whole new meaning to eat. Well, never mind, I'm not going there. And there are other non-medical biological brain treatments that we're going to be using with electricity and electromagnetism and aimed pulses of electromagnetics at specific brain regions to get specific changes. And you're going to see things in the next 15 years that are just going to blow your mind, and they're going to look impossible. So let's take a quick peek at the genetics. Here's the picture I showed you, only a couple things added. I told you the nucleus accumbens sends a serotonin signal up to the cortex saying everything's okay. And I'll explain the GABA inputs in just a second. So what if you have a mutation of your mu opioid receptor and you don't see your own endorphin, you don't release enough dopamine? We could give you a partial agonist of that mu opioid receptor, buprenorphine, which would cause the slow trickling release of dopamine and raise your tone. What if you had a very highly sensitive serotonin 2A receptor, which when you give a medicine, when you turn it on, actually lowers your dopamine tone? Well, we would know not to give you an SSRI, because if we gave you an SSRI antidepressant, you'd feel better at first because the serotonin would go up and your cortex would feel better, but then this dopamine would go down and that serotonin would fall. And then you'd cycle through this thing over and over and over again, and we actually call that SSRI poop out. And you've probably heard that SSRIs cause suicide in some people. Well, it's people with low midbrain dopamine primarily that happens to. And it's probably a good idea to be able to tell the difference between addiction and depression, because if you give the wrong person with addiction an SSRI, you could really increase his chances of dying. What if you have a nicotine receptor that doesn't work right? Remember I said that that it sits right next to the opioid receptor. We could give you a partial agonist of the nicotine receptor called Chantix, which would also cause a dribbling out of dopamine in a tonic way, no spike and crash, just like buprenorphine. Or let's say you don't even make enough dopamine. You can't release what you don't make. There's an enzyme here called methylene tetrahydrofolate reductase. Don't worry about the name. We'll call it MTHFR. And if you picture those letters in your mind, you know what we call it when we're not in public. It, oh, I just really need that aftershave. The MTHFR takes the folate in your diet and turns it into L-methylfolate, which is the only form of folate your brain can use to make dopamine. And so if you have a mutation of that, it doesn't matter how much folic acid you take in your diet, you're not going to have enough L-methylfolate and you're not going to make enough dopamine. The lucky thing is we could give you L-methylfolate. You can just take an L-methylfolate pill and then have enough L-methylfolate and make enough dopamine. Pretty simple fix. Or what if your dopamine reuptake pump, the thing that sucks the dopamine back up, it works overtime. And so the dopamine gets out there, but it never has a chance to hang out on the receptor because it's getting sucked back so fast. Remember I told you if you have less time, you have lower tone. Well, we could block that reuptake pump with a medicine called Wellbutrin, bupropion. Been around a long time, very common antidepressant, doesn't actually do anything to serotonin, it just works by increasing dopamine and norepinephrine. And it increases dopamine by sitting on that reuptake pump and blocking it. Also in that same spot, around that same spot, is another enzyme called monoamine oxidase B, and it breaks down dopamine. And yours could be genetically changed so that it runs overtime, and it's eating up all the dopamine before it can get packaged into those balloons to be sent out as a signal. And if that happens, even if you're sending out the right number of balloons because everything else works fine, they have less dopamine molecules in them and your dopamine release is going to be low. And if we see that, we can give you a medicine that blocks that enzyme. Or you could have a problem with your dopamine receptors. And while we don't have anything that can fix dopamine receptors, and let's say you're going to 12-step meetings and you're doing the 12 steps and you've got your genetic maximum, but your genetic maximum is lower than normal, we can raise dopamine there with the Wellbutrin again, even in people who have normal release, so that you can have enough dopamine to overcome the lower signal. And finally, I'll tell you about why I put GABA up here. There's a GABA B receptor on both of these groups of cells, and the GABA B receptor actually constrains the range of the high and the crash. Now remember I said that when people have low dopamine, they have a high spike, and as we raise their dopamine with the right medicine, the spike gets smaller. It's like it's smaller from the bottom. The top of the spike stays right where it's supposed to be, and the tone comes up to meet it. But in some people who have a special different kind of mutation on the dopamine 2 receptor, when they have a high spike from low dopamine tone, as we increase tone, the spike gets taller too. And we have to know that's going to happen so we can give them an agent, a GABA B, to constrain the size of the spike before we increase their dopamine. So that's what we're doing with genetics right now. Is there another one? No. So the goal is to normalize the dopamine tone and the hedonic function so that the person can participate in treatment. Because you're going to ask someone to sit in group or talk to you or go to a meeting or go to a group or do some homework, and how much better is he going to function and get out of your treatment? How much faster is treatment going to go? How much more effectively can we use the resources in this room to end addiction if people who are going to treatment are not restless, irritable, discontent, can't remember, can't think straight, can't pay attention, aren't motivated because of low dopamine tone? If we get the biological tone right, we can get more people into treatment and recovery. I used to not believe that. When I started in this field, I thought medicines were terrible and nobody should have medicines. And what happened to me was watching people die before they got into recovery changed my mind. And I started to learn how to use medications, and I've seen the opposite of what some people are afraid of. Some people are afraid that if we use medications in the treatment of addiction, we'll just get people to not get in recovery. They'll just use medicines instead. But that's not been my experience. My experience is actually I'm more successful at getting people to enter 12-step recovery with medication than before when I wasn't using medication. We had people we never would have gotten before. So remember the mission. To end addiction as a problem in American life in my lifetime, and I'm going to assume I have 30 years. I might be a little optimistic there. That would make me 87. But I'm going to assume that. How are we going to achieve that mission? We can't cure this thing today. Did I hit the wrong button? Yes, I did. We can't cure it today, and I don't know that we're ever going to have a cure. Even with all those amazing treatments we're going to have with the future from science, I don't know that we'll ever have a cure. We're here, take this treatment, and you're going to be fine. That's not only improbable, it's unnecessary. We don't need that. What we do need is to get everyone in this country with addiction into recovery. Because would we have a problem with addiction if everyone was in recovery? No. We'd have addiction, but we wouldn't have a problem with addiction. But that's 10 to 20% of the population. That's 66 million people. Are you guys ready to expand your treatment centers to be able to take care of that many people? You're not. Think about how we get trained for this. How many years does it take you to go from school to be able to really do this at a masterful level where you know you're comfortable and you're doing more good than harm? It takes years. We don't have years. If this thing's going to be gone in 30 years, we've got to hit the ground running. We're not going to get this done with the cottage industry we have now, with everybody separate, everybody doing their own thing, everybody looking at their bottom line, everybody focused on their way of doing it. It's not going to happen. We're going to need a new system, and that new system's going to have to be industrial in scale. I know that word scares the hell out of you. It scares the hell out of me, too. You have to ask yourself, are you willing to save the lives of 66 million people or not? And how scared are you willing to be to save 66 million lives? I'm pretty willing to go way out on a limb for 66 million people. Industrial in scale. Because there's got to be enough capacity. And it's got to work in a replicable way. And it's got to be easily taught. It can't be something that takes 10 years to learn how to do. It's going to address treatment at both and prevention at both a personal level and a societal level. When you walk out of here, it's going to hit you later. How many things in our society do we do that lower people's dopamine tone on a daily basis? How many people have addiction today, not because of any genetic problem, but because of where they live, or who they live with, or the messages they hear from society? And that they have low dopamine tone and end up with addiction because of things we could change. And real prevention is not ever going to work as long as we try to prevent the drug. We've been trying that for over 100 years. It's never worked. It's not going to work now. But there are preventive ways to end addiction, to end new cases coming in, if we understand how the disease actually works. And this new system's going to have to be efficient in execution, because we can't take a person in and then just keep treating them over and over and over and over and over and over and over again. We've got to be able to do the treatment we need to move that person from active addiction to full voluntary recovery, so that we can make room in our treatment system for the next guy, and the next guy, and the next guy. And the first guy's got to be able to go get into recovery and have a system to monitor him so that he's not taking up vital resources that are needed for someone who's in active addiction. And at the same time, it monitors him so that he can quickly get the care he needs if he destabilizes. So the goal, my goal, is to create more recovering people now and in the future. And if you have that goal, what logically derives from it are five quality priorities. And they're quality priorities because they're actually in order. Safety has to come first, because if we don't have safe treatment facilities, no one's coming. And courtesy and respect have to come second. Because if we don't treat people with courtesy and respect, they're going to have lower dopamine tone while they're in our treatment centers and nobody's staying. And we're going to have excellent care. And think about this. Every one of us is focused on excellent care every day, and I just told you there's two jobs more important than that. And we don't think of that on a daily basis. We're focused on excellence of care and outcomes and doing the right thing in our treatment. And there are two big jobs, if we're going to get this done, there are two big jobs we've got to get done before we even start talking about how good our care is. Because if we're not going to get, and if we're not going to do excellent care, people aren't going to be leaving into recovery and making more recovering people without us. And we're not going to get that multiplier effect. And we're so focused on the excellence of our care, we forget that we have to tell the world. But once we've achieved excellent care, we have to tell the world because there's 66 million people out there. 66 million people, who, most of whom do not know they could be treated, do not know they're dying. Only 16% of people with a drug or alcohol problem in this country ever get treatment. So we're not even talking about the other aspects or the other manifestations of addiction. So it's probably more like 10% of people ever get treatment. What percentage of them actually end up in recovery? We're talking about a huge proportion of that 66 million people who are actively dying right now while we're talking. So we have to tell the world. And then we're going to have to expand the system for all the people who are coming. Safety comes first because addiction is a dangerous place. And people come to us with their guards up, and their guards have to go down. They've got to know we've got their back. They've got to know that we've made safe treatment facilities and safe at every level of care, and we've got it covered, that safety's our responsibility, that they can relax and be a patient. The courtesy and respect, you know, there are enough places where my patients can go and be treated badly. They don't have to come to our treatment center to be treated badly. And one other aspect of this that most of us don't think about is, how often do you clean the trash cans in your waiting room? You probably don't think about that because you're busy doing treatment, right? Everyone at our place has a clinical job. The janitor has a clinical job. The receptionist has a clinical job. The person in HR who never sees a patient has a clinical job, because that person in HR, she affects my dopamine tone. And her affecting my dopamine tone affects my ability to treat the patient. Everyone at our place knows that lives depend on their actions. There's nobody who says, I just empty garbage cans. It doesn't matter. Because that overflowing trash can tells the patient nobody cares. You look at the chairs you're sitting on. Do they match? What would you think of the Bellagio if they didn't match? What would you think that the Bellagio thinks of you if the chairs didn't match, if there were holes in the carpet? They'd think, bunch of substance abusers, what do we care? This aspect of courtesy and respect doesn't just stop in our interactions. It's our physical plant. And maybe even more important, who answers the phone? And how many times does the phone have to ring? You would not believe how many patients we've gotten when we've asked, why'd you come to us? You answered the phone. We weren't their first choice, but we answered the phone. It's a simple courtesy. Answer the phone, have a person answer the phone and talk to another person. It's a simple courtesy, but it raises a dopamine tone from the other person, and they become more able to engage in treatment. Excellent care means cutting-edged, focused, individualized care at every level of treatment. How many of us talk about anger tonight at group because it's Wednesday, and on Wednesdays we talk about anger? Bob might not be needing to hear about anger today. And if we're going to take the whole group through the same process, no matter who in the group needs that process, what we're going to do is we're slowing somebody's treatment. And when we slow somebody's treatment, we're keeping a seat filled that could be filled by the next guy who needs it. Treatment's got to speed up. It's got to get more efficient and more effective, or we'll continue to have millions of people dying, and while they're dying, they're going to ruin the lives of other millions of people. After we get that treatment right, we're going to have to tell the world. I know that's going to be uncomfortable for you. It's uncomfortable for me. It was uncomfortable to do what Gary asked me to do, to mention my book. I don't like telling the world about me. I don't like that. I'll tell the world about addiction. I'll tell the world about how to fix this. I'll tell the world we all need to do it, but telling about me, it doesn't feel comfortable. So when it's tell the world how good our treatment is, it's a little uncomfortable. So you know what we do? We got accreditation, right? Let the Jacobs and the Carfs tell the world how good we are. Well, there's an alternative to that, though. We could put our outcomes out online. Let the world see how good we are, or not. And by outcomes, I do not mean what percentage of our successful graduates have not used a specific substance in 5 years. I mean something like, what percentage of people who called us for help are in recovery, progressing and trying 5 years later? I don't care if he had a slip. I care if he's trying. I care if he's in recovery. I care if he's trying to get the message and carrying the message to other people. If he had a slip 3 years ago, so what? That's not a negative outcome, because he got right back in and he's in recovery. But also, I don't want to just say the successful, it's not about the successful graduates. Because think about what we do when we do that. When we limit our outcomes to the people we like, the people we give our diploma to, the people we made jump through hoops, we're saying those other people don't matter. But they did. They came for help. And we're not going to build a system to help 66 million people unless we start counting the ones who we don't do such a good job with today. And what do we tell ourselves when they leave treatment early? He wasn't ready. He didn't want it bad enough. Next time you go to your doctor because you feel sick and he gives you a medicine for your pneumonia or your whatever, and it doesn't work, just remember you didn't want it enough. This is the only place in healthcare we talk about people like that. Anywhere else, you'd lose your license. We have to stop talking about patients as if they were actually choosing to be sick. They're patients. They're sick. It's our responsibility to understand how to engage people. And we're not going to get more people in unless we can do it and tell the world how to do it. And then we're going to have to expand the system, because we have to have the greater ability to get more people into treatment, or they've got to be attracted to treatment, right? And you can't make it hard to get into treatment, so there's going to have to be room for them. We are all focused on the most acute cases. We're all competing, to whatever extent we compete with each other, we're all competing for those few percentages of people who are like at their, what's the word, bottom? Who are willing to do what we want them to do. And we're waiting for the rest of those people to get sick enough to want what I have. Well, I got news for you. The bottom is a myth. Most people don't have a bottom. Most people just drop right through their bottom and die. Addiction kills people. It would be lovely if addiction was the disease we wanted it to be, and that we wrote down in 1981 and said, this is what it is and we're going to treat it. But it isn't that. We have to focus on the disease it is, or we're not going to make an impact. So remember my goal, and how the goal derives these five quality priorities, and they are in order. You may want to focus on excellence of care, but if you haven't focused on safety and courtesy and respect, there's not going to be enough people for you to have excellent care with. Remember why I'm doing this. I want to live in a world where a little girl doesn't know the meaning of the word addiction and can't fathom that such a thing ever existed. I so want to live in that world. And I got up this morning to try to convince you to join me in making it. Thanks very much for your attention.